today we are talking about, it's me and Anil Vishnoi. We are talking about OpenDaylight, OpenFlow and OVSDB use cases and the projects themselves. So I'm the PTL for the OpenFlow plugin project, and Anil is the PTL for the OVSDB project. Moving on. So, yeah, as I just mentioned, that we'll talk about the OpenFlow plugin project, followed by OVSDB project, and then the use cases and the references. So, as far as the project is concerned, the OpenFlow project will just go briefly into the overview of the OpenFlow plugin project and what's new in Boron, and a future direction of OpenFlow plugin project. Right. So OpenFlow plugin project, it started off in Hydrogen release, and it was one of the first community projects. So it's so it was started between various vendors, and the past and present contributors include people from contributors from Brocade, Cisco, Ericsson, HP, basically across the industry. And we have had around 97 people who have had actually at least a single commit, or basically the developers, like there have been 97 developers who have put in patches for the OpenFlow plugin project. And this is not just the developers. There have been contributions in other forms, from like in CSIT. There were a lot of contributions from Jamie Lewerson, who is the integration test team lead, as well as Luis Gomez, who's our test contact for the project. So basically, we have a lot of contributions from across the OpenDaylight community. And we have close to 1750 commits by people, and a lot of source code, and a lot of bug fixes. So OpenFlow plugin project as such is it's a pretty central project inside of OpenDaylight, because a lot of OpenDaylight use cases are actually based off OpenFlow protocol, as well as the OVSDB protocol, and making them working together. So we have around 20 plus consuming projects which consume OpenDaylight, OpenFlow plugin. And these include projects like the new NetVirt, which is the NetVirt VPN, SFC, VTN, GBP, NIC, etc. So it's got a pretty central role. As far as the OpenFlow plugin consumer model is concerned, so in a typical scenario, a user, I mean, if someone wants to program a flow, generally people, at least the end users, generally can write into the config data store that particular flow, which there will be a data change listener, and it will notify the forwarding rules manager, which is an application inside of OpenFlow plugin, which will in turn call RPCs for the core OpenFlow plugin, and which will pass that information to OpenFlow Java, the OpenFlow Java driver, and which will in turn program the OpenFlow switches. Once the flow is programmed onto the OVS or the OpenFlow switches, typically we also have the polling for the statistics, and once you receive a response from the switch about the flow, we will be pushing it comes to the OpenFlow plugin, and it will be pushing it as a YANG notification to the statistics manager, which in turn writes it into the data store, and that is kind of used by a lot of applications as a mechanism to confirm that the flow has been programmed. Similarly, other applications like VTN, GBP, etc., they do flow programming in different manners. So what I described was people programming into the config data store via the RESTconf or the REST API. But some other applications like VTN, they will directly call the RPCs of the OpenFlow plugin to program their flows. So as far as what do we actually support as of today, which is the Boron release, so we support OpenFlow 1.0 and OpenFlow 1.3, as well as I mentioned, flow programming via config data store or the RPCs. And there is also the commercial grade robustness features, like there is a clustering support. There is a reconciliation, which is a provisioning functionality which ensures that switches once there is a HA scenario like switch restart, the flows get pushed back to the switch. All the intended flows are actually programmed back to the switches. So this is kind of this is an absolutely necessary feature for without which commercial products will not work. And we also have the programming, batch flow programming for higher performance. So basically to send in a bulk number of flows at a time. The current team for the OpenFlow plugin, so I've just listed out the major contributors from the last two releases, and I'll not go through all the names over here, but we have a lot of folks contributing towards it. Of course, we at the same time, we are always short of people to contribute, so it's a paradox. So new in Boron is if you have been following the OpenDaylight OpenFlow plugin, you might have been hearing a lot about the Helium design, the Lithium design. So now we have standardized on this what used to be called as the Lithium design as a standard design. And a few of the important things about the Lithium design or the new design is that it's a cleaner design overall, which lends itself for current and future improvements in performance, and it also has a better API, a deterministic API, as well as better stats collection. The other feature, thing that was so over the last one or two releases, we have been implementing the OpenFlow clustering. So I believe the OpenFlow clustering, the first time we implemented was in Beryllium, it was not as stable as it should have been, or because it was the first time we had implemented. So inside of the MDSL project, during this current release, there was this new approach for clustering, called clustering singleton approach. I believe Robert Varga was talking in the side room, half an hour before, about the clustering changes inside of MDSL. OpenFlow plugin project was one of the projects which actually started using this facility. It basically provides and encapsulates all the leadership changes, and the OpenFlow plugin, users like OpenFlow plugin can now use the clustering singleton API to react to the leadership changes. So this is mostly to improve the robustness of the clustering solution. Other thing that I believe a lot of people across the community have been talking, especially Tom Pantelis from Brocade, about the blueprint migration. So OpenFlow plugin is one of the first, actually the first one to migrate towards the blueprint, and it's to enhance or replace the config subsystem, and basic idea is to improve the plugin upgradability and to have simpler configuration. So we have been talking a lot about the performance, but and we have been relying on the performance tools like Cbench for testing the performance. But we needed a little more easy to use test applications to test the performance for both the REST interface as well as for RPCs, and that was what was implemented during this in the Boron release, and it provides an easy to use interface basically for testing, for performance testing. An additional application that was added inside of OpenFlow plugin was this forwarding rules synchronizer, which is a new application for provisioning flows, groups, meters with the config data store, and it will be comparing the differences in the config between the data store changes and just sending the incremental updates, and include some retry mechanisms on failure. So it's a redesign of the forwarding rules manager that I had mentioned earlier. It's still a separate feature which we have not enabled by default currently, and we will look in the Carbon release. How much improvement this is and assess it. As well as there were other changes with respect to the feature cleanup and making the table features default, etc. As far as Carbon is concerned, the current flow programming model uses two level of OpenFlow flows or models for the flows. So you have the abstracted model for which is for both OpenFlow 1.0 and for OpenFlow 1.3, as well as it started out to be more abstracted to also take care of other protocols. Ultimately, we did not extend the flow programming model to the rest of the protocols, but historically that has been there. So. So you have the model at the controller level, which is more abstracted out, and the model at an OpenFlow Java library level, and we end up doing the translations between these two models, and this can probably hurt us in the performance, so we need to do a POC with respect to and study the what kind of performance penalties we are looking at, and if the penalty is significant, and it could very well be, we would like to expose a more high speed path for the OpenFlow 1.3 plus applications, because there's enough of difference between OpenFlow 1.0 and 1.3, but going forward, the difference is not as much in 1.4 or 1.5. It's there, but it's not a fundamental difference as was there before. Additionally, we want to have changes in the usability of the applications, to have config parameters, to have a better confirmation of the flow installation, as well as CLI info commands and stats collection, etc. For more about the OpenFlow plugin planning. There is a DDF session tomorrow at 12 o'clock, the design forum. And you're welcome to join there and contribute your thoughts about what are the features that you would like the OpenFlow plugin team to handle, as well as hopefully you guys can come and join us and start picking up some of the items. I think with this, I will give it to Anil. So we'll start with the OVSDB project.
Am I audible? Okay. So OVSDB project. So I quickly want to give you a little bit overview of, you know, a brief overview of OVSDB. So if you know, OVSDB is a project basically provide a plugin that help managing your OVSDB device. It supports two kind of schemas. One is OVSDB schema, which is basically a virtual switch, OVS we see in, you know, compute host, KVMs and all that. And the other schema it support is hardware VTAP schema. So all the you know, silicons who's kind of running the hardware VTAP on them, they you know, you can use OVSDB plugin to kind of manage those devices. So I added some of this stuff, you know, what OVSDB does and all that. But you know, we are going to talk about more in detail about OVSDB in a talk tomorrow morning, which I'm giving about the OVSDB project. And you know, if you want to get more details, you can go to this wiki page, and we have details about what this plugin support. So the crux I want to take out of this slide is this: there's another protocol that handles OVS. Okay, now. Why we are talking about OpenFlow and OVSDB together? Because, you know, they are different protocol, they are handling different devices. Okay, so there's no specific reason talking about it. But when it comes to, you know, OpenDaylight and how folks are consuming OpenDaylight, not within OpenDaylight, but external world, it's like OpenStack, OPNFV, and any of the virtualization solution builder, right? How they consume the OpenDaylight in a virtual space specifically, that's where, you know, these both of the protocol comes hand to hand. Okay, so some of the use cases that we target here, those use cases are very much about the network virtualizations. Okay, so if you look at this, you know, this is a general consumption model, how things work. Okay, very you know, very high level, very layman term, you know, kind of design it is. So you have application at the first layer. You have MD cell data store in there, so your applications put their configuration into a data store, and then you have two plugins. One is OVSDB southbound plugin and OpenFlow plugin. So what this plugin does, it actually goes to your machine and says, okay, you can create a bridge, you can create a termination point and all those things. So it just configure the device. Okay, so once applications say, okay, go, you know, to OVSDB southbound plugin, say go create a bridge and then connect that bridge to my controller back, and I want to use that bridge as an OpenFlow device. Okay, so configuring the OVSDB is come through plugin. Once it create the bridge and it set the controller for it, and then that device will act as an OpenFlow virtual switch. Okay, and that then it connect back to the controller, and this is how the cycle happens. So this is a general consumption model, and it's been used by many of the use cases, you know, which we are going to talk about. So, you know, if this is the high level picture that you need to keep in mind. So, and this is the control flow I'm talking about. So you create a bridge and then it connect back into the controller, and then controller can use it to program flows and all that. So this is a more detailed picture. So there's a more detailed picture about, you know, the internal component of it and all that, but I'm not going to go in detail because we are kind of running short on our time. So let's get to the use case. So this is a first use case, you know. This is basically the first project who started using both of them together when, you know, it initially started, you know, in Hydrogen release. So there are a lot of boxes here, but the things to look at here is, you know, this is NetVirt plus VPN service. VPN service we added it because recently we moved NetVirt to use VPN service code and all that. So so this project, how it consumes is, so on the northbound side you have OpenStack interfaces, and those OpenStack, you know, drivers, basically we have a networking ODL project, if you know. So that is for interfacing between OpenStack and OpenDaylight. So any configuration you do in OpenStack, create a network, spawn a VM attached to the network and all those operations. Those operations will come from OpenStack Neutron to the Neutron northbound project. that project is kind of a front facing from ODL side who interact with the OD OpenStack. And then it down goes to, you know, network provider. And network provider, what it does it, because from a southbound side, we connect all the compute node directly to the controller. Okay, so once this compute node is connected to the controller, NetVirt is your virtualization provider layer. So it sees there is a compute node, so it goes to the MDSL and say, okay, create a bridge on this particular compute node. And they name it, let's say, BRINT, which we see in, and you know, even OpenStack deployment or, you know, ODL-based OpenStack deployment, we see BRINT as a bridge that we create to kind of attach all the VMs and, you know, program it for a routing purpose. So yeah, NetVirt tell MDSL that, you know, this particular, you know, create a bridge on this particular compute node, and that request goes to OVSDB southbound plugin. And then it also set a controller to connect it back to the OpenFlow plugin. So once a bridge is created and the controller is set, then NetVirt basically used to dump all the pipelining flows that they use for a routing purpose through the southbound plugin, southbound OpenFlow plugin. So this is how the NetVirt kind of a consume. If you look at this, this is similar to the generic consumption model I shown you in a previous slide, right? So, and NetVirt basically use OVSDB also provide you a flow installation. You can do the flow installation using OVSDB. We don't support it, but you can always support it because you just, you know, it's a modification of the table. So you put flow in the table and that flow eventually will make it to the bridge. But it does not provide you all the goodness that OpenFlow plugin provides, right? Right, the reactiveness and reactive programming and all those things. So that's where, you know, NetVirt decided to use the OpenFlow plugin. And the recent version of the NetVirt, they use, you know, packet in and reactive programming pretty much for, you know, ARP responding, DHCP services and all that. That's where it's very critical for them to use OpenFlow for the flow programming. How much time I have? Okay, so we are running out of time. So service function chaining, you know, so this is pretty much the same use case. Yeah, but service function chaining use it for a different purpose. So service function chaining has, they wrote renderers for a different kind of devices. So, but those renderers are basically using these different protocol to configure the bridges. But SFC require different kind of configuration where they create a VXGPE port for SFC purpose, and they install flows that is heavily used by Nisira extensions. So they use Nisira extension, they don't use OpenFlow, you know, construct they use, but they heavily use the Nisira extension. That's where they use OpenFlow plugin very extensively. And it's very critical for them because, you know, a plugin, we have an extension, Nisira extension, or basically extension framework where you can add your own extensions and use it. So that's where OpenFlow plugin comes handy for them. So it's, you know, use both of the renderer and the things are going to be easy for you. Okay, so VTN, yeah, I'll give it to Abhijit to kind of quickly go through it and conclude it.
Sorry, I'd planned to cover more in detail for VTN, but since we are running out of time, I'll just quickly go through it. So VTN, it's a network virtualization project. It's been since the Hydrogen release, and it provides the multi-tenant virtualization with using OpenFlow, and as usual, things fault tolerant, supports OpenStack integration, supports clustering, and basically, the key idea is to it provides a logical abstraction plane which enables complete logical separation from the logical plane and the physical plane. So users can define topology in a logical plane and let the VTN application convert it into physical flows onto the actual hardware. So users can basically overlay layer 2, layer 3 topologies on and act as if it is a these VMs are quite independent of the physical network. It kind of hides the complexity of the underlying network from the tenant administrator and helps better manage the network resources as well as reduce the errors. The VTN components, if you look, it's very much similar to what one of the diagrams that Anil had mentioned, had shown earlier. And it's a similar model that that typically has been used in by the other applications. So VTN extensively uses certain OpenFlow features like the events, as well as it uses the RPCs, the different RPCs. I will stop here because I'm out of time. So. In consideration of the speaker. If you have questions, maybe Anil and I can answer, or we can catch up afterwards.